guiding light, Polaris, through time and space. In the vast canvas of the night sky, one star has guided humanity through the ages, serving as a steadfast beacon for explorers. For centuries, this celestial sentinel, known as Polaris, has been a reliable companion for those who dared to venture into the unknown. Its unwavering position in the northern sky made it an invaluable tool for early seafarers. It found its place in the intricate instruments of navigation, like the astrolabe and sextant. By aligning these tools with the polar axis, sailors could chart their course across vast oceans, relying on this star to find their way home. The Vikings, legendary explorers of the North Atlantic, were among the first to harness the power of Polaris, using its steadfast glow to forge new paths across treacherous waters. As empires rose and civilizations expanded, Polaris remained a guiding light. Even in the age of GPS and advanced technology, it continues to hold its place in the hearts of those who seek adventure. Join us in this video as we delve deeper into the mysteries of a star that has stood the test of time. Polaris history. The first documented observation of Polaris dates back thousands of years. It has been a prominent star in the northern sky for a very long time, making it difficult to pinpoint the exact moment of its first observation. However, it is known that various ancient cultures, such as the Greeks, Egyptians, and Chinese, were aware of Polaris and its significance in navigation. For example, the Greek astronomer Thales of Miletus, who lived around the 6th century BCE, is often credited with being one of the early observers of Polaris. He reportedly used the star for navigation. Similarly, ancient Egyptian astronomers and sailors likely recognized the reliability of Polaris for determining direction, particularly in the context of the Nile River navigation. In Chinese astronomy, Polaris was known as the tail of the dragon and was an important reference point in their celestial observations. However, dear viewer, Polaris has not always been the important guide it is today. Sure, Greeks might have used it for navigation, but they were also using a bunch of other stars in various constellations. We could say Polaris was just one of the many stars in the sky. But you must know that the night sky changes over time because nothing in the universe stays the same. Everything in the cosmos is subject to change, and stars are no exception. First things first, all stars move on their own. For instance, the entire solar system is moving along with the sun in the vast expanse of the universe. However, most stars are so distant that in practice you will never see them actually moving. If you could live for centuries, you would notice some change. Not only that, over the ensuing centuries, the effect of Earth's precession slowly moved the celestial pole's position. The position of stars as seen from Earth is therefore defined by two main contributions: the relative changing position between the solar system and the star, and the precession of the Earth's axis. The latter can only change the star's location on the plane of the sky, while the former also changes the actual distance of the star from the sun. For these reasons, in Ptolemy's day, 2nd century AD, there was no bright star near the North Celestial Pole. For instance, Polaris, also called Alpha Ursae Minoris because it is the brightest star in that constellation, was then some 11 degrees away. Kochab, another star in the same constellation, was closer, but only by a couple of degrees. During that time, the entire constellation of Ursa Minor was used for navigation rather than any single star. Then, over centuries, the effect of precession slowly moved the celestial pole towards Polaris, and it came so close to the pole to be the closest naked eye star, even though still at a distance of several degrees. This happened in the early medieval period. In Old English, it was known as Ship Star. Then it slowly took on the name of Stella Polaris, especially in books by Stifler and Peter Apian in the early 16th century. At that time, our star was still around 3.5 degrees from the celestial pole, 5 times farther than it is at present, but was clearly becoming accepted as the pole star. Currently, Polaris lies within 1 degree of the exact north celestial pole, close enough to make it an excellent guide star for navigators. It will reach its closest to the North Celestial Pole around AD 2100, when the separation will be less than half a degree. After that, precession will just as inexorably move the celestial pole away from it again. As I will explain later, contrary to common belief, Polaris is not particularly bright. It is in fact of magnitude 2.0, just on the fringe of the top 50 brightest stars as seen by the naked eye. However, before getting to know the star from a more physical point of view, I would like to stress once again the importance of this star in history. Have you ever heard of the Underground Railroad? This was a network of secret routes and safe houses used by enslaved African Americans to escape to freedom in the 19th century, primarily in the United States. The North Star was a powerful symbol of hope and freedom for those seeking to escape slavery. It served as a visual reference point in the night sky, indicating the general direction of the North. They used to refer to the Big Dipper, the constellation that points to the North Star, as Drinking Gourd. These were common themes in the songs and spirituals of enslaved African Americans. Songs like these contained hidden messages and instructions for those planning to escape. For example, the lyrics of the spiritual Follow the Drinking Gourd included directions like, "When the sun comes back and the first quail calls, follow the drinking gourd. For the old man is waiting for to carry you to freedom, follow the drinking gourd." Pretty clever, huh? Later on, Polaris became associated with the abolitionist movement, which advocated for the end of slavery. Hey, before moving on, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can improve it for you, the viewer. Plus, don't forget to subscribe to our channel by making sure to hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our daily videos. Polaris, stellar characteristics. Polaris is classified as a Cepheid variable star. This means that its brightness fluctuates in a regular and predictable manner over time. In the case of Polaris, its variations in brightness are linked to pulsations in its outer layers, which expand and contract. This relationship, known as the period-luminosity relationship, makes Cepheid variables one of the most important star types in astrophysics. The key discovery made by astronomers Henrietta Swan Leavitt in the early 20th century was that there exists a direct correlation between the period of a Cepheid's pulsation and its intrinsic luminosity. In other words, Cepheids with longer pulsation periods are intrinsically more luminous than those with shorter periods. This period-luminosity relationship revolutionized our ability to measure cosmic distances. By observing the period of a Cepheid's pulsation and measuring its apparent brightness, astronomers can deduce its absolute luminosity. Comparing this known luminosity to its observed brightness provides a direct estimate of its distance from Earth. This method, known as the standard candle technique, has been used to determine distances to nearby galaxies and establish the cosmic distance scale. For this exact reason, Cepheid-based distant measurements are pivotal in determining the rate of expansion of the universe, quantified by the Hubble constant. This constant is a fundamental parameter in cosmology, influencing our understanding of the age, size, and fate of the universe. Now imagine you're observing a Cepheid star in the night sky over a period of time. You take regular pictures or measurements of the star's brightness. As the Cepheid pulsates, it gets brighter and then dimmer in a predictable pattern. You record these changes in brightness over each pulsation cycle. Next, you plot these measurements on a graph. Time is usually along the bottom, x-axis, and brightness is on the side, y-axis. Each measurement point represents how bright the star was at a specific moment in time. When you connect the dots, you get a wavy line on the graph. This wavy line is the Cepheid's light curve. It shows the repeating pattern of brightness and dimming as the star pulsates. This light curve was obtained by space telescope tests and shows how Polaris brightness evolves over time. Analyzing this light curve, astronomers can determine the period of pulsation, how long it takes for one complete cycle, and use the period-luminosity relationship to calculate the star's intrinsic brightness as we mentioned above. Polaris distance. Polaris is now estimated to be 433 light-years away from Earth. These measurements mainly come from two amazing astrometric surveys, Hipparchos and Gaia. These two revolutionized astronomy as we know it, measuring the parallax of countless stars in the Milky Way. Never heard of the parallax method to compute stellar distances? Let me break it down for you easily. Imagine looking at an object from two different positions. It will appear to shift its position against the background. Now hold your finger in front of your face and close one eye, then switch and close the other eye. Your finger seems to jump a little. That's because your eyes are slightly apart, so they see things from different angles. In space, we use the Earth's orbit around the Sun to act like our two positions. We look at a star when the Earth is on one side of its orbit, and then again about 6 months later when the Earth is on the other side. The star appears to move against the background of more distant stars. By measuring this apparent shift, we can calculate the distance to the star. The brighter the shift, the closer the star is. This method is especially useful for stars that are relatively close to us in space. The Hipparco spacecraft utilized stellar parallax to gather measurements between 1989 and 1993, achieving an impressive accuracy of 0.97 milliarc seconds. It successfully provided precise distant measurements for stars located up to 1,000 parsecs away. Subsequently, the Hipparco's data underwent a re-evaluation, employing more advanced error correction and statistical techniques. Despite the overall benefits of this astrometric mission, some scrutiny arose regarding the accuracy of its data for Polaris, primarily due to uncertainties in its measurements. Certain researchers have raised questions about Hipparco's reliability in measuring binary Cepheids like our North Star. Although the specific reduction process for Polaris data from Hipparco's has been re-evaluated and confirmed, a consensus regarding its distance has not yet been universally established. On the other hand, we have Gaia. This mission releases its data to the public in a series of data releases which contain a wealth of information about the stars and other celestial objects observed by the satellite. Each release builds on the previous one, providing more detailed and accurate measurements. Gaia states that its bright limit is at about 3 mag, while Polaris is a star of magnitude 2, which makes it too bright to be in the catalog. For this reason, Gaia Data Release 2 did not include a parallax for Polaris AA, but a distance inferred from its 445.5 light-years for Polaris B, somewhat further than most previous estimates and several times more accurate. This was further improved to 447.6 light-years upon publication of the Gaia Data Release 3 catalog on June 13, 2022. As evident, determining the exact distance to Polaris is a sensitive undertaking, and ongoing research aims to refine our understanding of its precise location in relation to us. Polaris, exoplanets, and habitability. Polaris is also classified as a supergiant star. This designation indicates that it is in the late stage of its stellar evolution. Supergiants are massive stars and have exhausted their nuclear fuel, causing their outer layers to expand to immense proportions. Polaris is estimated to be approximately 4.5 times more massive than our Sun, and its diameter is over 40 times larger. There have been no confirmed planets detected in orbit around Polaris, but discussing this point might be more delicate than you think. Indeed, when we see Polaris in the sky, we are actually observing three unresolved stars: Polaris AA, Polaris AB, and Polaris B. Instead, when we say Polaris, we usually refer to Polaris AA alone, which is the supergiant we are talking about. Polaris AB revolves around AA, a star similar to the Sun. However, the fact that AA is a Cepheid poses a challenge for life as we know it. The intense pulsations from the powerful central star and its orbiting companion make it highly unlikely for any planets to have formed in such a turbulent environment. If by chance any planets did exist, they would have been rendered uninhabitable due to the destructive radiation. Fortunately, the system includes a third star, Polaris B, which is a regular Sun-like star. It orbits the A's at a distance of 2,400 astronomical units. The presence of Polaris B opens up the possibility of planets orbiting it, potentially even hospitable ones. Polaris death. One intriguing aspect of astrophysics is its ability to predict the fate of a star based solely on its physical attributes, like its mass. This is a feat beyond our capabilities when it comes to human beings. So what lies ahead in the life cycle of Polaris? As a supergiant, Polaris finds itself in the advanced phases of its stellar evolution. It's probable that it has depleted its nuclear fuel and is presently engaged in processes that will ultimately culminate in the formation of a white dwarf, as it is not massive enough to undergo a supernova explosion. Polaris, poems, and songs. Polaris, being a star of significant cultural and navigational importance, has found its way into the realms of sailors, musicians, and poets alike. In The Rime of the Ancient Mariner by Samuel Taylor Coleridge, for instance, the North Star is eloquently mentioned in part 4 of the poem. Farewell, farewell, but I tell to thee, my friend, the best. The water's wild, the water's mild. To them I bid farewell. And I will swear by the single hair of the North Star, and the skies they were, and the winds that howled like demons mad, and the sea that round the ship was spread, in her sides with arrows pierced so fast that the same moment I was blessed. This passage depicts the ancient mariner bidding farewell to the waters, sealing his oath with the solemnity of the North Star. Its inclusion adds both a poetic and navigational dimension to the narrative. Even in the world of children's entertainment, Polaris makes an appearance. In the popular cartoon Peppa Pig, there's a delightful song dedicated to the North Star. North Star, North Star, are you near or are you far? Can we get there in the car? Polaris, the end of an era. Unfortunately, Polaris's era as the North Star will eventually come to an end. As a result of precession, the position of the celestial pole changes gradually over thousands of years. Around the year 2100 CE, the North Celestial Pole will have shifted significantly so that another star, Gamma Cephei, also known as Array, will become the closest bright star to the celestial pole, and it will be referred to as the North Star for a period of time. After more millennia of precession, Vega in the constellation Lyra will eventually become the North Star around the year 14,000 CE. This celestial transition alone underscores its significance, but Vega's importance doesn't end there. Its unique attributes have also made it a cornerstone in the field of astronomy. Its brightness and stable properties have made it an ideal reference point for the magnitude system, a scale that quantifies the brightness of celestial objects. This standardized system, integral to astronomical study, owes much of its precision and global acceptability to Vega's steadfast brilliance in the night sky. But how does it work exactly? Using a specialized instrument, the astronomer measures the amount of light coming from both stars through a specific filter, which isolates a particular range of wavelengths. This filter corresponds to one of the standard astronomical passbands. Let's say the instrument provides the following readings. Vega, magnitude 0 in the chosen filter. Star X, magnitude 2 in the same filter. This means that in this specific filter, Vega appears brighter than star X by exactly 2 magnitudes. Since the magnitude system is logarithmic, this implies that Vega is approximately 2.5 times brighter in this filter compared to star X. Easy peasy, no? Anyway, the precision of the Earth's axis over centuries is a continuous process, and over extremely long timescales, many other stars will take on the role of the North Star and Vega. It's just a matter of time. As we approach the end of this video, Polaris holds a special place in our hearts. Its steady twinkle feels like a familiar embrace, a reminder that we're never truly alone. It's a timeless connection that spans generations, reminding us of our shared journey through the vastness of the universe. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching. Have you ever used Polaris as a guiding light at night? Let us know in the comments below. We'll see you next time on the channel.